طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. So as I said before, these hikam, the way that I understand them, they are kind of building towards something. They're successive in terms of the meanings, and they're specifically addressed more or less to what we would call the salik, someone who has already made the realization that the key to success in life and in the next is by rectification of the heart, and that can only come about by traversing the obstacles and pitfalls of the ego or the nafs. And maybe for many of you that sounds like, well, yeah, of course, that's common sense, and why wouldn't we think that? But I think for many people, it's not so common. And I think for many people, we're still looking at kind of obstacles on the periphery, on the outside, you know. And we, a lot of people talk about change, societies have to change, and attitudes have to change. And I think people think that via enough shouting about it, or protesting about it, or legislating new laws to affect it, will somehow make those changes. And that's not going to change what really needs to be changed. What needs to be changed is people's hearts. And you cannot change a society by enforcing a code upon society. So that which is going to rectify society is the same exact thing that's going to rectify the members who make up that society. We don't have this abstract concept called society, al-mujtama. I don't recall anywhere in the Sunnah where the Prophet ﷺ refers to the community of believers as al-mujtama, as society in the modern sense. What he calls it is an ummah. What he calls it is ukhuwa, brotherhood, an ummah, right? An ummah doesn't mean society, and it doesn't mean nation of Muslims, right? Ummah means ummah Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? When we talk about ummah, the ummah always has to refer back to a particular prophet. That's our understanding of ummah. So when we say ummat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ummat Musa, ummat Isa, ummat Dawood, وهكذا. So ummat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is referring to the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is everyone who is subject to the da'wah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which means everyone who lived with him and after him. And that includes everyone. Go back to our example. Donald Trump is a member of ummat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When me, you, and Donald Trump are crossing the Sirat, the land bridge between hell and the Hawd, the body of water of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the lake of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the pond, and we're crossing and we feel like we're about to fall, I'm going to call and say, you are Muhammadah, and so is Donald Trump. That's what it means to be from ummat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's who we're going to call upon on that particular instance. So everybody is with us in that sense. They're all from the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that which is going to fix the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the very same thing is going to fix the individual hearts of every member of the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I don't believe in social engineering. I don't believe we're going to have like this sort of top-down social scheme that we're going to apply and then it's going to fix everything. You can make all the laws that you want, right? And many of this, you in this room can attest to the fact, and many of you live through the civil rights movement and beyond, and you can see that the laws on the books say a particular thing, but what's in people's hearts and the actual interaction is something else. So the law didn't change that. Government didn't change that. Enacting certain things, even the amounts of protests that were done, didn't actually change that. What's going to change that is working on every single member of this ummah, right? And helping them and leading them and inviting them to change, to become something that can be much better than where they're at right now. And that's why I think books like this, this is the key. People are up in arms about the latest executive order and, you know, this executive order coming next week and all this type of thing. And I'm not saying that we should not have responses to that that are somewhat political in nature. Obviously, that's part of the whole kind of way of looking at things. But I don't think, I don't believe it's going to be the panacea. It's not going to be the solution, right? It's not going to get us to be the respected minority that we're seeking. My dreams, my hopes, my aspirations, I think many of you, it's beyond being a respected minority. I don't want to be a respected minority. I want to help people. I want to share with them what I have. I want to invite to them what I know. Why should they live in darkness? I live in the light and they're my neighbors. How is that fair? And as long as I think I'm taking this attitude of just respect me for who I am because of my identity, that's not fair to them. Let me show you who I am. Let's show them who we are. And showing them who we are is not going to be by raising placards and posters and screaming about it and demanding it. Respect is earned, right? And we have to do our part, and we have to show people that we can show them something much, much better than what they think of us and where they're at right now. And we can't do that unless we embody that which we're seeking. We cannot be petty. We cannot be revenge seeking. We cannot be getting offended at every slight. Because that's part of the program. That's part of the package. Of course, that's going to happen. What do you think the Sahaba went through? What do you think the companions went through all those years? They couldn't walk in the streets of Mecca except that they heard a word from there, a word from here, a word from this. What did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam say? Even when they get to Al-Madina, they found it with some people. And when they would say to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, As-salamu alaykum, which sounds like salam, but it's not. As-salam min as-sum, poison. They would make fun of. Isn't that mocking Islam? Isn't that mocking the greeting of Muslims? What did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam instruct the Sahaba to do when that happened? Oh, you got to raise a whole lot of hell and you don't let them get away with that. And guess what? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam at that particular time, they're actually in charge. They were not the respected minority. They were the in power majority. So he could have done more, right? He could have done anything he wanted. So what did he say to the companions? When Aisha responded, and she heard one of them say that, she said, "Wa alaykum as-salam wa la'natullah." Poison back to you guys and the curse of God. How about that? Take that. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he heard this. He said, "Ya Aisha, yakfiki?" We said, "Wa alaykum." Just say wa alaykum. Just say same to you. Don't go beyond that, right? Don't go beyond bounds. Even though, if we wanted to do something to them, we could have. But he instructed her and said, don't do that. That's not what we're here. Right? إِنَّمَا أَنَّمْ أُبْعَثْ لَعَانًا وَلَا فَحَّاشًا وَلَا سَخَّامًا فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ. I was not sent as a curser, someone who curses people and who defames people. That's not why I was sent. I was sent as رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. I was sent as a mercy to the worlds. To the degree that a few years later, the Prophet ﷺ marries the daughter of the chief of those tribes, of the Jewish tribes that were saying these things to the Prophet ﷺ. Safiyyah bint Huyay, radiallahu anha. She was the daughter of them. Not just the daughter of any of them. She was the daughter of the head person of the chief. And even then, right? Because people are people. Remember we talked about Abu Dharr al-Ghifari and Sayyidina Bilal. Even the wives of the Prophet ﷺ, as is normal, were jealous. So they would say, oh, she's the Jewish wife, even though she accepted Islam. So she complained to the Prophet ﷺ. Prophet ﷺ could have went to his wife and said, don't any one of you dare say anything to her again, otherwise I might divorce you, or I might do this, or I might do that. He didn't do that. He said, yeah, Sufayya, if they say this to you, just tell them, what do you think of a person whose uncle is Moses, and whose husband is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Just tell them that. See how he deals with what you would think would be an intolerable, difficult, impossible situation, but he greets it with what? Not with rocks, with light, with love. That's how he greeted it. And he understood even those people, the position of those who were in opposition. He didn't dismiss them. He didn't try to alienate them and completely disenfranchise them or make them irrelevant. Let's annihilate them completely. Why? Because they're mad'u. They are part of the invitation. Think about if you have a big invitation party at your house and you try and invite all the people who are your neighbors, some of your relatives, and you know people coming from out of town, and certainly they don't all get along. But you have to manage all of that. So when you invite them over, you think, oh my God, my mother-in-law really doesn't like my third cousin. They just like want to rip their hair out when they see each other. So what do you do when you have both of them in the same room and you're trying to manage that situation? Do you take one side over the other? Do you try to, you know, if there's a fire that's ignited, do you add gasoline to the fire? Or do you try to extinguish it? Or do you try to reconcile it? Or you try to say good things? You know, we have a principle in the deen that says الضرورات تبيح المحظورات ودفع الأخس بالخسيس, that necessities make certain things that were normally prohibited unprohibited, ودفع الأخس بالخسيس, and we repel things that are the most despicable with things that are less despicable. So one of the few times it is allowed, I wouldn't say encouraged, but merely allowed, by which to kind of play around with the truth a little bit, is when you're trying to reconcile between two people or two groups of people. What's called Islah al-Bain. Why? Because having that relationship being spoilt and corrupted is worse in the eyes of God than lying about what someone thinks about you so that you can bring them together. Yeah, they're both not good. But the worst situation is that this relationship goes sour and it's spoiled and it's ruined, right? Because you couldn't get them together. They couldn't sit down and talk about their issues and try to reconcile them. So one of the best things that one could possibly work at is Islah al-Bain, to try to fix relationships. Prophet ﷺ always tried to fix relationships. He would never give up. Always tried to bring people together. Yes, there are times when relationships have to be severed. Otherwise, we wouldn't have divorce. But even that one, it's still related as the most detestable thing that's allowed. The most detested thing is divorce, right? Because it's a severance of a relationship. And some relationships can't be severed. Between parents and children, for example, can never be severed. You're not allowed to sever that relationship. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said that, you know, you want to find this deen, right? Then, يعني, تصل من قطعك. Then you have to make the link between even those who've tried to break the link with you. So it's not enough to say, well, they don't want to talk to me, so I'm not talking to them. They don't want to talk to me, I will still ask about them. I will still try to re-engage as much as possible. They don't want to, that's up to them. But at least from my part, from my end, I did what I had to do. Rather than kind of letting it even encourage people to break relationships. How could you be friends with them? How can we be friends with this person? Did you know what they said? Or do you know what they said about you? That's how people talk today, right? That's what people put on their Facebook all day. All day they're like reposting all this stuff like, oh, look what they said, look what they did here. Oh my God, did you see this thing? And the lisan al-hal, right? The tongue of the situation, not of the actual thing they're saying is, I want you to completely dismiss and think the worst of this person or this group of people. That's what we call lisan al-hal. Even though it doesn't say that, but that's the meaning behind it. That's what they want you to get at. And, you know, the deen doesn't tell you to do that. The deen tells you to have husn al-dhan, have a good opinion of people. If you find, you can put someone in a good situation, good opinion about what you think of them, then don't do so. Don't hesitate to do that. And tajassus and su' al-dhan, right, spying on people, having a bad opinion of people, these are all things prohibited by the deen. Why? Because it severs relationships. And the whole idea is that you want to build relationships, you want to maintain them, you want to nurture them, you want them to prosper and flourish and flower. And that can't happen when you're always thinking the worst about people. So, and that's not going to happen by laws, I don't think, and by political campaigns. And it's certainly not going to happen in the echo chambers of people's Facebook feeds. It makes you worse. What is going to happen is you get a chance to actually rectify your heart, right? Because your heart is like a mirror. It's mirroring what's happening on outside. So if your mirror is like convex or concave, and it give, you know, when you go to the, they don't have this anymore, but the, well, they used to have in those amusement parks, the funny mirror, what's it called? Huh? Awesome. You know, the mirror like makes you look really fat or really skinnier. Kids don't care about that stuff anymore. But back in our day, we used to have that. So that's what your heart is like. So you look at the mirror and you're like, wait a minute, I don't look like that. But your mirror is going to reflect everything outside. So the what you think about that person, they're not really like that. The problem is with your mirror, not with them. You're not seeing it. It's based upon waham, something that's delusional, right? Not on the reality of how they really are. And I see this, I haven't lived that long, I'm 40 plus years, but I feel like in the time that we're in right now, I've never seen it as bad as we're living right now. In terms of all of the mutual suspicion and the bad opinions that people have of others. And I'm talking about Muslims, I'm not even talking about Muslims with Muslims. The way that we're looking at each other and what we think of one another and all this type of thing, it's really based upon not reality, right? And we have these tools of society now that just facilitate this and make it easier. Social media and the way that you can only get the things that people who are like you see those things. And then we have this whole echo chamber effect and the confirmation bias effect. So if we hear from something that we were expecting and it confirms what we already thought about that person, then we'll repost it. Because, hey, look, see, it's like I said, you know, exactly what I said. This person believes this, this, and this, right? And they'll post an article where they said this, this, and this. And you go read the article and you're like, what are you talking? I don't see what you're seeing. It's not as damning as that you think it is. But because they had that meaning already inside, then it's like confirming what they already thought. And then this goes back and forth and so forth. And so, you know, the sound-minded thing to do is be like, hold on, wait a second, hold on, slow down. I need to recognize within myself my own biases, my own prejudice, right? If I could see that, and I could see it from the outside and recognize that my mirror is not properly reflecting, then let me cover myself, let me protect myself. But the thing that people are less and less desirous of using, even though we need it the most now, and that thing is silence. Guess what? All of your Facebook friends, they don't need to know your opinion about this thing. It's not going to add a lot to the world. It's not going to change much. Maybe if you just didn't say anything and just mull it over a little bit, think about it a little bit before you kind of want to make a comment about this or repost that or send this thing out. Just think about it. Silence, right? Silence is one of the most powerful tools of change. Silence is one of the most powerful tools of changing societies. And you'd be like, what? We've got to be doing something. We've got to do something about this. Let's get down and we've got to do something, right? When people, many, many people start saying, you got to do something, then I think it's the time to say, maybe we don't got to do anything. Maybe it's the time to be resolute, right? Samt. Right? Samt is different than a sukut. Sukut in Arabic means you're silent because you don't have another option. You've been silenced. So it's not really a mawqif. It's not a position. Amma samt. That means I choose to be silent. Right? And if you look at the people who've chosen to be silent in the Quranic paradigm, they were powerful people and they caused huge change. Who is one of them? Maryam alayhi salam. What did she say? إني نظرت للرحمن صوما فلن أكلم اليوم إنسيا. I have pledged, I've made an oath, a vow to the Rahman after she had the virgin birth. I am not going to speak to anyone. Because what could I say? What's she going to say? oh, you know, this angel came in and he told me you're going to have a baby, and then he blew into my womb, and then and miraculously the baby came out, and I was under the palm tree, and I shook, the dates came, and I ate them, and in an instant he was born. And then the palm tree gave these dates, and we're in the winter, or it's not even in season, and it came down, and no one's going to believe it. Right? So she said, إِنِّي أَضَلْتُ مِنَ الرَّحْمَنِ صَوْمًا فَلَأُكَلِّمَ الْيَوْمَ إِنْسِيَّ فَأَتَتْ بِهِ قَوْمَهَا تَحْمِلُ. But she had a baby. She couldn't just stay in the room in the temple that had been dedicated for the service of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People would notice, what is this? فَأَتَتْ بِهَا قَوْمَهَا تَحْمِلُ. She brought her baby to her people. They said, what? لَقَدْ جِئْتِ شَيْئًا فَرِيًّا. You've come with something. What? How are we going to understand this? And you might even be a little bit understanding. What would you think when you see, even though you know that she has no contact with men, that she's been living in dedicated to worship in the temple, because her mother thought she was going to have a boy. And usually what they want to do with one of the children is dedicate to the worship of God. But it turned out to be a girl. But she had made that promise to herself and to Allah. So she said, even though it's a girl, and there were no other women worshipping like her and dedicated solely to the service of Allah in that temple, nevertheless, Maryam was one of them, the only one. And so, when was the opportunity? How could it have happened? So she went to them, and they saw, لَقَدْ جِئْتِ شَيْءٍ فَرِيَّ مَا كَانَ بُقِي امْرَأَ سَوْءٍ وَمَا كَانَتْ أُمُّكِ بَغِيَّ. Right? Your father was not an evil man. Nor is your mother a prostitute. Where would you get this from? How would you learn this? But she said, إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ صَوْمًا. I have made a pledge of silence. And it's in Quran is called sawm, the same word that we use for fasting. So it was a choice. It was a choice. فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. Then she pointed to the baby in the cradle, baby Jesus. فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. Then what happened? He spoke. And what did he say? What were the first words out of his mouth? Inni Abdullah. I am the slave of Allah, the slave of God. And he spoke. So her silence and her vow of silence, her samt, was powerful. And Allah made it even more powerful by bringing about something unexpected. And he spoke. So sometimes we can use this as an example, as like a parable, that being sound, being resolute, refusing to engage in the pettiness that people are trying to coax us into. As Muslims, we are some of the most easily provoked people. I don't know why. We're so easily provoked. Anything will like get us like all excited and off teeter and like seeking revenge and seeking this and that. Let's take things slowly. Let's take like a collective possession of samt and sawm and fasting and contemplation. Not weakness. The modern world tells you that if you don't do something, that means that you're going to show them that you're weak. Right? If you pardon them, if you're nice to them, then they're going to think you're weak. Only a weak person thinks that. Right? Only a weak person thinks like I have to be kind of giving them lefts and rights and uppercuts and things like this, or otherwise, you know, I'm going to be weak. What did Ali do in the thriller in Manila? What did he do for like, or was it the one in Africa with Ken Norton? With Foreman. What did he do for like 10 rounds? Rope-a-dope, right? He didn't do anything. People are like, oh my God, he's losing the fight. He doesn't know what to do. He's not even throwing punches. He's not doing anything. Allah yarhamu, rahimahullah. But he taught us what? Well, sometimes he knows what he's doing. Right? He's saving his energy. He knows what he has to do to win this fight. And he did exactly the thing against a more stronger, powerful, a bigger opponent. He knew what he had to do. And he did it, executed it perfectly. Perfectly. Right now, we're the smaller opponent. We're not in the position of, you know, taking George Foreman and putting him on the ropes and giving uppercuts and refs and lifts and, you know, doing what we want. No, we're Ali in this particular scenario. So maybe we have to do a little bit of dodging. You know, maybe we have to put our gloves up and take a little bit of it. Right? Maybe we have to be a little bit patient, a little bit resolute, you know, and wait for when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the door and the opportunity for us. Allah a'lam. But I think, you know, in times of fitna, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us that the one who is sitting is better than the one who is standing, and the one who is laying down is better than the one who is sitting. And that's a metaphor, that taking a position of samt, of sawm, of refrain, right? And not just jumping into the melee, not just jumping into the thing and saying, well, let's shake it up, see what's going to happen. Because as Muslims, we've been doing that for the past 30, 40, 50 years, and it's brought nothing for us but disaster. It has brought disaster. Look at the Muslim-Arab world right now, it's a complete shambles, because people thought they can just jump in and shake it up. And it doesn't work. It's been proven over and over again, it doesn't work. That, you know, every human being is important, every human being represents a human soul, and that human soul has a human heart, and they are all lock boxes that have a key that can open them. And we shouldn't dismiss anybody and make kind of all of these adversaries all over the place, and we forget about our own selves, we forget about our own hearts. So anyway, back to the Hikam. Oh, that took a long time. All right. So this third one, these Hikam also are, some of them have said that they're kind of operationalizing or actualizing Tawheed. So don't think they're just like a kind of sort of this spiritual psychology that's kind of just based upon a knowledge of the inclinations and the passions of the human heart. While that may be definitely a part of it, but the most important aspect of it is that it's a recognition, an affirmation of reality as it is. And the reality is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought us all into existence when we never existed before, and He is the one who is maintaining our existence. And if He didn't maintain our existence, we all wouldn't be here. So it's not like He just threw us in the ring and then said, Assalamu alaikum, and left. No, every single instant of your life, it's Allah making a choice. It's Allah choosing for you to stay here. And once He removes that and says, I don't want you to be here anymore, you will no longer be. So every second that you continue to live, it means Allah is choosing this for you. So that's significant. And it's not you choosing for yourself. It's Allah choosing that for you. So aqidah or tawheed is extremely pivotal and essential into how we go about understanding ourselves. مَنْ عَرَفَ نَفْسَهُ عَرَفَ رَبَّهُ. Whoever knows themselves then can know their Lord. So some of these hikams sometimes will give you one of them or a few of them that are explicitly or almost exclusively just about tawheed, like this one, the third one, where he says, سَوَابِقِ الْحِمَمِ لَا تَخْرِقُ أَسْوَارِ الْأَقْدَارِ. Aspiration which rushes on ahead cannot break through the walls of qadr or destiny. And what he means by this is that everything happens by Allah's will. Everything happens by Allah's choice. Everything happens because Allah knows it and makes it happen. Nothing that happens in all of the universe or whatever happened in all of the universe is going to go anywhere or any direction or in any small amount against that. Not possible. Impossible. So what it's telling you is your himma, your aspiration, and you're like, well, I want to be this and I want to do that and I want to be doing this. Keep in mind that it's not going to pierce, you know, it's using metaphorical language, imaginary language, it's not going to pierce the walls of destiny. In other words, what Allah has willed for you, He knows what's going to happen for you. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not human in that sense. Don't think that Allah, He's coming to learn things. You know, He learned something new about you today. No, his knowledge is not renewable. Ours is, we come to learn things, we forget things, we may relearn them, that's us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't forget anything, and He doesn't come to learn things. His knowledge now is as it was always and will always be. All of Allah's attributes are like that. Every single one of them. His knowledge, His will, His power, They will always be now, as they always were, and as they always will be in the future. So for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no such thing as time. Time is irrelevant. So you can't imagine how that is. So like, if I take this book and I say, here is the beginning of time, here is the middle, here is where it's all going to end. We don't know that timeline. But for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's all the same. Whether we put our finger here, or put it here, or put it here, it's all exactly the same. And so what's going to happen to you? You're like a little blip. You're like this thing over here, nothing. In terms of that whole overall timeline, that scheme. So whatever desire, aspiration, or passion you have, keep in mind that it's just merely fulfilling Allah's overall plan for you. And this has manifestations, practical manifestations, many things. And there's a whole section on dua that comes about the fifth or sixth of these hikam. But your dua, your supplication, asking Allah for things, is not so much about changing Allah's mind. You can't do that. Remember, Allah is unaffected by us. There's nothing you can do to affect Allah. Not possible. Do you think He needs your iman? That it increases Him? Or if you are fall into kufr, that decreases Him? Evidently. It's nothing. Do you think Allah would be decreased if there was nothing of this at all, if He never chose to create the universe? No. The hadith in Ibn Majah of the Prophet ﷺ, كَانَ اللَّهُ وَلَا شَيْءَ غَيْرُهُ. There was Allah and there was nothing else. Ibn Atta al-Sakandari completes that hadith with a meaning that's built upon it in a later hikmah, where he says, كَانَ اللَّهُ وَلَا شَيْءَ مَعَهُ وَلَا شَيْءَ غَيْرُهُ وَهُوَ الْآنَ عَلَى مَا عَلَيْهِ كَانَ. And He is now as He was before. So one of the things about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He's immutable, He's unchangeable. That's what differentiates, one of the things that differentiates Him from us. He can't change. He is not affected by things. So whatever we choose to do, don't think that it's a relationship of you affecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our supplication, our dua, has other reasons for it, other means. And we understand in other ways. So when I start asking Allah for a particular thing, what does that mean? It means it's a sign Allah wants to give it to you, because in His overall plan, that thing you're asking for that's on your tongue is something that is you are destined to have. Otherwise, you wouldn't be asking for it. See how it's understood? Not that I want to, okay, I'm going to make this dua and change Allah's mind about this thing. No, you don't change His mind. But if it's on your tongue, if it's there, or if that meaning is in your heart and you want it, that's a sign Allah wants to give it to you. He may give it to you in this life, or He may give it to you in the next life, but know for certainty it's going to be yours. It's coming. So your himma, in as much as that you want and desire things, keep in mind it's not going to change the walls of destiny. It's not going to pierce the walls of destiny. So anything that we do in this life, always keep in mind that it's subject to the will and the power and the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can't go outside of that. And so our reliance then should be not so much on what we do, but on rather our relationship, our understanding of the divine, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the thing that's more powerful and will really change and affect you, rather than thinking you have implicit power in the things that you do. No change will happen unless Allah wants it to change. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغَيْرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيْرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah does not change with what is with the people until they change that which was in themselves. So you want things to change? Then the thing that Allah has given you responsibility for, amana, is changing what's in here. We can't change certain things all by ourselves, but you can change what's in here, right? You may not have the power to impeach the president, but you do have the power to be nice to people. You do have the power to greet people with a kind greeting, to practice the sunnah and your best ability, to pray the five prayers a day. So these are the things you're going to be held responsible for. Allah will not hold you responsible for things it's not in your power to do. You will not be burdened by them. And the sins of others is one of those things we're not responsible for. وَلَا تِزِرُوا وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. That's not our issue. So we'll move on to the fourth one. where he says, Rahimahullah, أرح نفسك من التدبير فما قام به غيرك عنك فلا تقم به لنفسك. This is kind of an extension of like the practical meaning of the one that just came before. So he says, give yourself a rest from what he calls tadbir, which means, it's very hard, difficult word to translate. I have not found a good translation for it as of yet. Sometimes they translate it as planning. Here he has forecasting. But tadbir, where he's telling you to give a break from it, means, I think, why I understand it, planning in the way where you have a sense of dependence and reliability on the steps of your plan or the parts of your plan more than you do on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, أَرِحْ نَفْسَكَ مِنَ التَّدْبِيرِ. Don't burden yourself with that. Give yourself a break because it's very taxing on you, right? When you have to like, oh my God, I got to come up with a plan for this thing, and you know, first I have to do A, and then A leads to B, and then B leads to C, and C leads to D, and something goes wrong in that thing, then the whole thing's not going to work. What am I going to do? I got to make sure this thing works, blah, 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 blah. أَرِحْ نَفْسَكَ مِنَ التَّدْبِيرِ. Why? فَمَا قَامَ بِهِ غَيْرُكَ عَنْكْ لَا تَقُمْ بِهِ لِنَفْسِكَ. Because when someone else is doing it for you, then why should you do it for yourself? So this idea of tadbir, the overall plan in your life. You know, ask any of our brothers who've seen a lot of life, like Imam Ali Abdul Malik or others, ask them if where they're at today is what they imagined they'd be at 20 years ago, or 10 years ago, or 30 years ago. Is this exactly how you planned it? That this is what you'd be doing and this is where you'd be at? Is that how it went from the beginning? I can't think of a person who would say yes to that. Nobody could say yes to that, right? Things just happen. Doors open, doors close, paths change, you know, detours here and there. That's life. What we see as kind of chaotic and kind of all jumbled together and it doesn't seem to make sense, that's from our perspective. Because it's not going according to our plan, but it's going according to whose plan? Allah's plan is exactly according to plan. Nothing will go outside of Allah's plan. It will be exactly the way He wanted it. Every single step. Nothing is out of sync. Perfectly. That's how He wanted it. So stop worrying about it. In other words, stop holding the burden in your heart about how things are going to turn out. Because it's not your problem. All that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks you to do is put in your part, in your effort, in your limited capacity as a human being, as an inferior being to God, to do what you can do. And you have a limited sense of volition of making choices, and Allah is going to take us to account on those choices, but that's it. He's not going to take us to account on anything more than that. We're not burdened with other stuff. We don't know, need to know how old the universe is, right? Or how tall Adam alayhi salam was when he was. We don't need to know things like that. You may read about it in books and people give speculation, but none of that are we burdened with. We're only burdened with those things that are particular to you, that are within your capacity. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُكَلِّفُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا مَا وَسْعَهَا. Allah is not going to burden a soul except that which he can bear. So there's no تَكْلِيف بِالْمُحَال. You're not going to be asked to do something that's impossible. Nothing will be impossible. أخي, but you know what? I have really bad knees and I can't pray standing up. It's just impossible. Then you don't have to pray standing up. Right? There's always going to be, in your particular situation, there may be an exception. Okay, I really want to go to Hajj and Umrah, but I don't have the means, and I don't think I'm ever going to have the means. Then Allah's never going to ask you about it. End of discussion. Right? So those things that are not in your capacity, then you're not asked about it. Only those things within your capacity. And so don't fret too much about how the overall plan is going and where's it going to be and stuff like that. Does it mean that, however, I don't think about the circumstances and the ramifications and the results of things before they do them? No, obviously not. You have to think about those things. That's a wajib, right? That's the adab with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But don't put your heart's reliance on the efficiency of your steps, of your plan. And then if it goes opposite to what you wanted, then beware. Don't say the word if. Right? They said, لو مدخل للشيطان. If is a gateway for Satan. Why? Because you say, well, if I had done this, If I had only done that, you know, if I was, you know, better at this, if that person didn't do this, then, you know, it would have been differently. If all those illegal voters didn't vote, then I would have won the popular vote. What? If, don't say if, once it's done and it's happened, right, there's nothing that you could have done that would have changed it. Because if you submit to that, then that means that somehow you're going to change the plan of God. That's not possible. So, does it mean that we don't learn from our mistakes? No, we learn from our mistakes. Right? That sin that you did or that mistake that you made, learn from it. But learn to move on from it too. Right? Allah has given us a beautiful thing to allow us to move on from our mistakes. Can you imagine the mistake of our father Adam alayhi salam? He ate from the tree, and instead of being in paradise, Jannah, the thing that we all want to get to, he's lowered to earth. But yet, we don't think of Adam like that. We say that he was ennobled, right? He was a noble being. He was an infallible being. And that so-called mistake in his right wasn't intentional, wasn't a sin in the traditional sense, even though we can still call it a mistake. But can you imagine what he must have thought, how he felt like? But Allah gave him something. Had he had not given him that, had he had not done that mistake, then all of us would be lost. And what is that? This idea of tawbah, of learning to return from your mistakes, learning to recover from your mistakes. كل إنسان خطاء وخير الخطائين التوابون. Every single human being makes mistakes. And خطاء means كثير الخطايا, makes many mistakes. Not a few, everybody makes a lot. But the best of those who make mistakes are those who return, التوابون, who are constantly, not التائبون, التوابون, right? The ones who are constantly returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, their whole life is about returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the whole thing. So, had it not been for that initial mistake, we would have never known that. فَتَلَقَّى أَدُوٌ مِّن رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَإِشْ فَتَابَ عَلِيْهِ. He was taught these kalimat, astaghfirullah, tubtu ilayk, fataba ali, and he was forgiven. So, don't fret over those things. You're going to make mistakes, learn from them, repent from them, and resolve that the next time the situation or similar circumstance comes up, that you're going to do better. That's all that Allah requires from you. So that which Allah has already taken care of you, the overall plan of your life and all that's going on, that's not your problem. Allah has taken care of that. But you will truly not become, I think Munawi said it, or Junaid, you truly will not become a true person of Allah until the only time that you think about is your present. Why? What's the past? Done. There's nothing you can do about that. And what's the future? Not guaranteed, because it may never happen. So then what are you supposed to be busy with then? Your present. Yes. Your present. That's what you're supposed to be busy with. Right? If you keep looking into like what I'm gonna do 3 weeks from now or next year or this and that, well, what about till then? And who says that's guaranteed? And the things that happened in the past, you can't go back. So all that you have is your present. So if you just see your present, right, and you see your present as everything, that's almost godlike. Why? Because we said earlier that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no past, present, or future. It's all like a single point. It's not a timeline. And so when the Quran says kunu rabbaniyin, right, there are some of the sifat of Allah, some of the attributes of God, that's for takhalluq, that you can take on yourself. One of those things is stop worrying about the past and stop worrying about the future. Stop grieving over the past and stop worrying about the future, but be in the present. That's how Allah describes the awliya in the Quran. إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. So there's khawf and there's huzn. Those are other words for past, for future and past. Because الخوف, right, means khawf من المستقبل. Fear means fear of the future. You don't fear your past, you fear the future. وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. nor do they despair or grieve. What do people grieve over? Not their future, their past. So the awliya, la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. Alladhina amanu wa kanu yattaqun. Lahum al-bushra fi al-hayat ad-dunya wa fi al-akhirah. La tabdila li kalimati Allah. Dhalika al-fawz al-azim. That's it. Don't worry about don't grieve over the past. Don't worry about the future. Alladhina amanu wa kanu yattaqun. Iman, taqwa. Lahum al-bushra fi al-hayat ad-dunya. The good signs, the anwar, the alamat, the spiritual life will happen for you in this life. And most definitely in the last life, in the akhirah. Man ashraqat bidayatuhu, ashraqat nihayatuhu. Another hikmah. Whoever's beginning is enlightened, then his end will be enlightened. So all of these things are alamat. Right? One of the things about the akhirah is that we, in this life, we live a life of where the images are deceiving and false, and the meanings behind them are what's sought, is what's true. In the next life, the images themselves will be true and will reflect the meanings. That's why when the Prophet ﷺ described in the Isra al-Mi'raj, when he saw people being chastised, right? He saw physical things happening to people. The guy who had his tongue and he's like carrying over his shoulder and is breaking his back, the backbiter. Why? Because what's the tongue is the tool of the one who backbites. And so in the next life, هذه المعاني ستجسد. These meanings will be actual forms. Whereas in this life, ignore the forms and look at the meanings. In the next life, the forms come to life and they become the meanings. يوم تشهد عليهم أرجلهم وألسنتهم. The day that their legs and their arms and their tongues will bear witness against them. Your body parts will bear witness against you, literally. Literally. Right? So what was only meanings in this will become forms in the next. Why? Because in this life we worship forms and we forget the meanings. The golden cow is a form. There's no meaning behind it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is formless. There's no form to Him. It's meaning. But in the next life, those meanings come to life. That's why what is described as the greatest thing anyone could be given in this life and the next is to gaze upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is formless, who is without surah. So the gaze upon Him will be something we can't even understand in this life, because the only gaze we can understand is reflecting of light with your eyes. And our ulama said that's impossible. That's not going to happen, because Allah is not going to change for the next life. He will be then as He is now. So what we're going to be gazing upon is something outside of our comprehension. The Prophet ﷺ only could have used imaginative language to describe it to the Sahaba. When they gazed upon the full moon in the middle of the desert in Medina, Laylatul Badr, right? And they looked at that, he said, you will see your Lord as you see that. Not that you're going to see Allah look like a moon, a'udhu billah. What it means is, in its clarity and its distinctiveness, and you will not mistake it, you will know what you were looking at. That will be in the next life. So do not be deceived by the suwar, by the forms in this life. Right? That's not the idea. The idea is the meanings behind them. The meanings behind them. Sidq, amana, ikhlas, tawakkul. Right? These are all things that pertain to the heart. Right? These are the meanings of the heart. This is what defines you. And then we're talking about, you know, what color you are, or what language you speak, or what country you immigrated from, and we're using these as the barriers to divide us. How petty and foolish. How stupid is that? Or even gender. How stupid is that? What is that? They're meaningless in the next life. Your soul is not subject to gender or color or ethnicity or language that it speaks. Your soul is way beyond that. So why are we using all these things to kind of just hammer and sledge one another and beat each other over the head with it? Oh, you're not a man, so you're never going to understand. Well, you're not a woman, you're never going to understand. Well, you're not black, so you're never going to understand. Well, you're not white, so you're never going to understand. And you're not this, so you're never going to understand. How about we just try to understand the basic humanity in each and every single one of us? And let's not worry about that other stuff for now. Let's unite upon that which can unite us. And all that other stuff, that's Satan's plan. He was the first racist. He is the one who indicated the idea of your outward form gives you some type of preference. No one said that before him. No one was thinking, the angels didn't, the angels were asked to prostrate too. Were they not? Did they say, wait, Allah, hold on a second. We're from light. We're from nur. That's what we're created from. He's from clay? And you want us to prostrate before him? They didn't think like that. They didn't say that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was the one who said this. I'm from fire. He's from clay. I'm different. Why would I prostrate to him? Right? And the prostration wasn't for him. It was for Allah. Right? We call it a prostration of ta'zim, not of ibadah. It's a prostration of recognizing the command of Allah for you to do so. Not that you are worshipping the thing you are prostrating to. Not every prostration is an act of worship. In that sense, that you're prostrating before that thing. That's why they said, even if you see someone who prostrate before a statue, that doesn't mean he's worshipping it. Don't call him a mushrik. You don't know what that means. So the prostration before Adam alayhi salam that all were commanded to, the jinn and the angels, this is you are enacting and following the command of God. It's nothing more than that. And he failed that test. He was tested because he had it inside him all along. It's not like all of a sudden he became bad. He was inside him all along. So that means all of his outward acts that he was doing for how many hundreds or thousands of years before that, right? And he seemed like to be this faithful servant of God. Outwardly, he wasn't. He never was. And only on the imtihan, when the test came, did he show his true colors, as they say. His true colors came out when he was tested. That means everybody's true colors are going to come out when they're tested. What are our true colors when we're tested? It's very easy to be all nice and good when people are all nice and good to you. But what if people are not nice to you? What comes out then? Especially when you have the power to enact your revenge and retribution. You can do it without consequence. Think about that for a second. What if you could be what's inside your heart and you can do stuff to people? And you can do it without consequence. What a test. What a test if that was in our hands. I would never want that for myself. Never. What a responsibility. What a test. But yet, people seek that. People want to be in that position. They want to get to that because they think that they're going to be these purveyors of justice and good. No, that's all different. That guy, he's a tyrant. When I'm in that position, it's going to be all different when I do it. Really? What do you think he said before he got there? What do you think he was saying? So, low Adam. I think we went over time. It's 3:30. So we'll stop here, inshallah, for Asr. Jazakumullah khair.